The patient is male at 63 years old with clinical presentation with pelvic and femoral claudication, both sides at 50 meters. Comorbidity is coronary artery diseases after myocardial infarction and primary peripotent coronary interventions with drug-eluting stent of LAD and in the second step, recanalization of right coronary artery. Diabetes type 2, arterial hypertension and dyslipidemia. Risk factors of atherosclerosis is male, age, smoker and genetic predisposition. Arterial ultrasound and ankle brachial index. Abdominal aorta is with distal thrombosis and significant stenosis of superior mesenteric artery and thrombosis iliac artery on both sides and collateral flow distal from common femoral artery. Ankle brachial index in right side is 0.45, in a left one is 0.4. This is a collateral flow with color Doppler of common femoral artery, left and right. Here is a significant stenosis of superior mesenteric artery, and here is distal thrombosis from the CT angiography. The therapeutic options is vascular surgery with aorto-bifemoral bypass, total endovascular revascularization with stent implantation, and maximal medication treatment plus walking exercise. And our choice is total endovascular treatment with right brachial approach and both femoral approach. Now let's start the live case.
Okay,
thank you.
Also we have presentation about the So can you show us what we have done till now and what stage you are?
Yeah, you probably saw the CT. It's
yes.
The so-called Heilerisch. Heilerisch, just distally to the renal arteries and quite a long occlusion. So we can show you step by step what we have done to this moment. So to be deductive, let's say, we have in fact took a picture of both mammary arteries in order to show you the possibilities of having collateral circulation to the distal iliac and common femoral arteries, like shown here. We have used performed in fact, like Dr. Janevska mentioned, both femoral and brachial artery approach, so totally endovascular approach. So we are going to, I will show you. So this was the angio of the right mammary, and this is the late phase of the right internal mammary. That we have used the roadmap of the late phase in order to puncture the right femoral, common femoral, because there was no pulsation at all. There was a small surprise, so this is the puncture under the late phase roadmap. Okay. So when we entered the left subclavian artery, the surprise was that was a critical stenosis just at the ostium of the subclavian artery, but nevertheless, it's very interesting. You are going to see the lima. The lima is filled by the vertebral artery. So there is a
full.
Now you are going to see that there is a competitive flow into the left internal vertebra that is filling the subclavian and the mammaria. So this is the left mammary artery, and when we are going down, we are going to see the filling through the epigastric arteries going to the left common femoral artery that was used again as a roadmap in order to puncture the left femoral. This is our usual approach to use at least one brachial and one femoral approach. In this case, we decided to have one brachial and two femoral approaches in order to have the possibility to put, let's say, big stents in both iliac arteries in case we are successful to recanalize the occlusion, the Lerisch. What is your comment? Something different from what you are doing?
No, you start well. I just want to know the distance between the lower renal artery and the beginning of the thrombosis. How many centimeters you have of neck?
We can measure very, very exact. We can do a very exact measurement. You know, the biggest problem, you probably know from the trials that after endovascular recanalization of Lerisch syndrome, the advice is to put stent grafts and to make reconstruction with two kissing grafts within the aortic stent graft. So at least at the aortic level, we are planning, in case we successfully recanalize the occlusion, to put a stent graft just below the renal arteries. We have done this maneuver several times with a free flow endurant aortic endograft, just below the renal arteries, but definitely after good predilation, good preparation of the aorta. So this is the plan.
Did you reopen the right side yet or not?
Okay, I will show you the step-by-step approach. In fact, from the right side, the wire from below went aside, so into Faust lumen dissection. And from above, with a microcatheter from the brachial artery and the brachial guiding sheath, we went, I will show you now. So this is the occlusion, you see, immediately after the renals. And you see, probably you see the 90 centimeters long
shuttle sheath. It is actually less than 1 centimeter below the left renal artery.
Yeah, in fact, less than one, probably 5 millimeters.
Half centimeter.
Yeah,
half,
yeah, okay, yes. So, and we succeeded to cross. I mentioned that from below, there was a trend to go in fact Faust lumen. Like in this situation, you see the looped wire aside, so it's into the Faust lumen. But fortunately, from above, you see now the 018 wire. Dr. Stanko succeeded to cross the lesion all the way down to the femoral and the SFA. And in order to have true and true, so to have double access from the brachial and the femoral with one wire, the true and true maneuver, in fact, we have used a snare. We have used a snare. With the snare, we have externalized the wire. And after making snaring the wire and the sheath, you see the markers of the sheath, so we externalized the wire and the trailblazer microcatheter. And through the lumen of the trailblazer, we went up, and on a such a way, we have, in fact, a good 0.35 access from the femoral very distally into the proximal thoracic aorta. This is on the left side, externalization.
Thank you, Dr. Stankov.
Yeah, Dr. Stankov is the master.
Oh,
and
yeah,
okay, this is the removal of the wire from the sheath, and again the sheath back. This is the balloon predilation on the left side.
Okay. A very long balloon.
Very long balloon, absolutely.
30 centimeters, maybe more.
Yeah, it's it's 200 millimeter, 6 by 200, and it's over 0.14, very long shaft, 180, in order to have enough distance, enough length to go from the brachial to the ear. Okay, we had similar experience on the right side. From below, we went into the dissection. And, okay, this is the distal cup. You see the same loop going probably in the same Faust lumen. And this was telling us, because the wires were going into the same Faust lumen, more than logic, probably they could be reached on a, on a certain place. And even more, by the microcatheter over the wire, we saw there is a flow. So obviously, in case there is a flow, more than obvious, there is a communication in some place. And we succeeded to cross from above with 0.18 this communication. And again, we snared the 0.18 wire. And now we have a very good approach from above and also approach from below. And this is the predilation in a moment we are going to see, the predilation. So probably you can see live the balloon inflation on the right side.
That is the same balloon or what is the size?
No, it's another one. It's another one. We are planning now to make a kissing balloon inflation. And okay, and after that, we are prepared to make IVUS with the high definition assist IVUS catheter.
You, I have a question. You are doing
both sides. So now we are proceeding. With
Hi Ivo, you are doing great so far. I have a question. You are very, very close to the renal arteries. Do you think about protecting them somehow? Because there is, I think there would be a lot of thrombotic material there. So you easily cross the lesions with the wire to the both femoral arteries from above. And I think there is some kind of thrombotic material. And do you have any cautious approach during the ballooning? Is there any measure you are taking?
No, not now. Not now, in fact. We saw the picture of the CT. There was no dramatic thrombus containment. But we are ready to do that because we are going to have bilateral femoral access. And probably we can, from above, we can put some guiding catheter or
vent technique, maybe.
Or make the so-called vent technique during the implantation of the Endurant. We have some experience with the vent technique that is used with the Nelix device.
Which device?
Nelix. Uh-huh. Nelix device. It's a kissing endografts for AAA. So it's they don't agree to use the term vent technique, but it's similar. It's like chimney, but not with stent graft, but with bare stents.
Okay. So, comments from the panelists?
No, I have no
I'm listening to your proposals.
Something different in the strategy?
No, we follow him. He's doing the right thing. I feel confident with Ivo.
Okay, so we can proceed now with
the... So, Ivo, you have a complete approval from the whole panel.
You can go on.
Покритата част
70. Free flow.
Yes. Listening to you.
Okay, can you show us what you have done? And because we stopped after kissing balloon dilatation of the aorta and common iliac. So
okay, we've done probably you can see now the last subtracted image.
Yes.
In fact, you see that still we made also IVUS, and the residual stenosis after kissing balloon was very, very tight. It's very well seen also on the angio. We made also kissing balloon with two 10 millimeter balloons, and we have used the 40 millimeter length of the two balloons to measure the distance between the renals and the bifurcation, like Jack asked me. So you can observe that, okay, the bifurcation is more or less at the distal marker. So we have 80 millimeter distance between the renal and the bifurcation. And we are planning now, we are prepared because we have placed on the left side the 12 French sheet and the Lunderquist wire. So we are ready, we are prepared now.
12 French sheets from left or from the right?
From the left.
From the left.
We put the 12 French sheets from the left, and we are ready to make a sheetless implantation of the Endurant. That is the covered part of the Endurant is 70 millimeters. So we can expect the distal part of the Endurant to finish more or less 1 centimeter above the anatomical bifurcation. And after putting the Endurant stent graft, we are going to perform a better balloon dilation, but already under the protection of the stent graft. So without the risk of debris embolization distally.
Yes,
you see,
important.
The Endurant is coming, and we are more or less on site. We are going to check now, and no will change.
Okay. What is the diameter of Endurant?
The diameter of the Endurant is
25.
Okay. That is not bad.
Big diameter.
If it's possible to say something, Dr. Nicole, I think you have problem with the right renal artery now.
Yes, we need more information how the orifice of the renal is, because we have the impression it's a little bit underperfused. Yes, also on the right side, I see it's delayed the contrast. It
influences the right side.
It's possible that at the end you need also to stent the orifices of the renal.
Most probably, yes, absolutely right. In fact, we are planning to do that, but in fact, the right renal artery is quite above. So the left renal artery is the lower one, it's almost 1 centimeter below the right. So I can remove a little the sheet, the arm sheet, in order to show you the situation with the renals. Okay, yeah. Okay, so.
The left looks like pinched in the.
It was visible on the previous image.
Absolutely. Probably the best way would be to put a guiding catheter into the arm sheet and to prepare to stent the left.
Yes.
The left renal. Yeah, to make the vent. Okay,
yes.
Let's go. The Endurant is on good side, and we are going to proceed now with five French Jenkins right guiding sheath in order to selectively go into the pinched left renal artery. And I will ask my colleagues to go back one projection to David Nazar.
Ivo, because we are, should we have to observe the case or?
Yeah, maybe we can wait that you canalize renal. I can have a talk in this time.
Yes, okay, I agree, totally agree.
because we see that you made a kissing stent implantation now. Can you explain?
Yeah, yes.
Because we left you after endurant implantation.
Yeah, in fact, it's very crucial to emphasize, go back, to emphasize that in fact we implanted a stent, the osteocritical osteorenal stenosis.
Yes.
And we have used the stent implanted into the renal artery by two reasons. Of course, to make correction of the atherosclerotic critical stenosis of the renal, and also to position the proximal part of the endurant just at the level of the renal artery and even touching a little the renal artery. So this is the so-called vent technique. And within the endurant, we implanted simultaneously, next one.
Okay. What was the size of stent in the renal artery?
Great, there are two stents, 12 by 80. In the renal is 5 by 19 dynamic renal. So it's by purpose I mentioned the name of the stent because it's the dedicated one, dynamic yes. renal with a good radial force, and it has the force to invaginate a little the tip of the graft of the endurant, so to keep the renal artery open with small protrusion, about 3-4 millimeter protrusion within the aorta. And this is the simultaneous implantation of the two self-expandable 19-0 stents into the proximal iliac arteries with a very good overlapping, at least 1 centimeter and a half within the stent graft, within the endurant. And now we are going to prolong the two 19-0 stents from the proximal to the distal iliac artery, in fact, just after the hypogastric bifurcation. And that's it. And after putting the two 10 millimeter stents, we are going to be ready for completion, probably angiogram, after making the post dilation with two 10 millimeter balloons.
Yes, okay. So we will come back to you after the next presentation.
Unfortunately, the movie, the film, is too big, and there was problem during the imaging transferring. So mainly I have to retell you.
Yes.
So without having the possibility to show you, but I will show you now on the live screen. You see the endurant.
Yes.
We have implanted two stents, 12 millimeter within the endurant casing, two 10 millimeter stent as a prolongation of the 12 millimeter stent, and two 8 millimeter stents. And now we are going to make a subtraction, and hopefully for final, even we don't know what is the situation because we didn't make a registration of anything, let's say officially. Не диши, пръскай. Not very good.
This is injection from where?
This injection from above. From above. So there is probably there the probability.
But I think that probably you're somewhere selectively in
Maybe catheter isn't, yeah.
Yes. Just go higher and inject.
There is an option, the catheter. No, probably we are. No,
yes,
we are
it is prolong, edge dissection, probably.
Yeah, we are going to prolong the endurant with a non-covered stent.
Probably you have to also check ACT and your anticoagulation.
Yes, this is a very good.
Just
good
check
remark.
The heparin, ACT, and because now you have to switch to some chimney technique for the saving of the renal arteries. If you implant some disc above.
Yeah, it's. I think it will be fine.
Wall stent. Okay. Yes.
24
wall stent на 70 имаме.
Давай.
Давай 24 на 70 wall stent.
So you will implant a regular stent?
Yeah, we are going to implant a regular wall stent.
Okay.
Maybe 24.
Maybe we can continue with the program and we will go back after you implant the stent. So what we see that you implanted the wall stent above the endurant, and what
exactly
next?
Exactly, and this improved the things. We saw a small extravasation on the level of the left iliac artery. Go back. Okay. Play. Yeah. So,
yes.
Do you see there is a extravasation on the level of the left iliac artery, and because of that, next we
How
implant
is the blood
this
pressure?
It's 125.
Excellent.
And this is the stent graft implantation, Bentley 8x57. Next. And this is after the Bentley implantation, so there is no any more extravasation.
Excellent.
Is it true that we don't see the right renal artery?
Yeah, you are right. The right renal artery is not very well seen.
Yes,
so probably we are going to stop on the iliac and aortic level, and we are going to try to recanalize the right renal artery.
Yes, and the left, practically the result in the stent of the left renal is, let's say, not
it's
perfect.
Good. It's acceptable, I'll say. So you see that...
Maybe a wire and balloon will be useful there, especially in the in this case with the occlusion of the right renal.
Yes, exactly.
Just at least one wire for safety, just...
Absolutely right.
To keep it open and finally you can make a ballooning just for sure.
Yeah. We are, you saw we succeeded to cross the struts.
Yes.
And, but unfortunately the wire is a side of the stent. And now we are going to leave, this wire there in order to stabilize the system. And we are going to cross within the stent with a second wire, I mean the renal stent. And most probably we are going to limit ourselves with opening the left renal artery very well, because the contrast is a significant amount. And that's it.
How much is the contrast?
Yeah, it's 300 milliliters.
And what is the GFR of the patient?
It's normal.
Normal.
Normal. So it's absolutely normal, and it's under hydration.
Because
but nevertheless,
you have you crushed the ostium of the renal stent now, and you have to recross.
Yeah, most probably we are going to recross from the ostium to the middle part, and we are going to implant another one.
Yes, this is another option.
Yeah,
if it's not
absolutely.
Possible, yes, if it's not possible to recross the stent, is just to crush the older one, the previous one, and to restore the patency.
Exactly, absolutely right.
What kind of wire is that?
It's a whisper.
You're still behind the stent struts, I think.
So we decided already. We are going to cross.
Okay.
And we are going to put a second stent ostially.
Okay.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, good. Дайте ми 3 на 15.
Maybe some larger, longer balloon will be good option because
yeah, in order to make the
exit. You have to crush also the stand, so
yes,
15
right.
Could be a little bit shorter.
Great point, absolutely. Great point.
We'll stay with you because actually you and Zoran are the last lecturers, so...
In fact, my idea is to postpone these two lectures, to cancel. It's useless, I think.
Okay, we will cancel it. Yeah. And if you agree, we can stay with you or to close the session, how you prefer.
It's up to you. Probably follow me to crash
yes.
the stand.
Yes,
and
I okay. think that it will be good just to see how you will manage this. It
yeah.
will be also practical, I think, for the colleagues, because
it because is we learn most from complications,
yes.
not from our successes.
Well, this is real life. I mean, this is real life.
Yeah, you're right. This
it
is
cannot
real
be
life,
everything to go perfect. When everything go perfect, we are great. But
yes.
this is the point where the real life comes and we have to manage this. Any suggestions from the audience?
Is patient fit for any surgical revascularizations, maybe of the right kidney?
I see that they crushed the stent. This is a non-compliant or compliant balloon?
This is a semi-compliant balloon.
Semi-compliant, okay.
And it seems that the artery is huge.
Yes. But we have to keep in mind that not always it could be on the posterior wall, and sometimes it looks that the stent is staying the same, but it is actually ellipsoid, and crushing is on the AP projection. So. This is what we see at the moment. It does not mean that the stent is not crushed.
No. I'm going to open now the struts in the ostium with a 5 millimeter non-compliant balloon.
Yes.
And after that, we are going to put a short, probably 6 millimeter stent at the ostium. And that's
why
it.
Don't you try a little bit longer stent, because it will be easier to position it just to escape this flow movement, because very
in
short
fact,
stent could
in
slip
fact,
easily.
The shortest that we have is 19, so it will be perfect, I think.
19 is okay.
Yeah.
And how you decide to manage the occlusion of the right renal artery?
Good question. I'm listening to your proposals.
Maybe if you try with ultimate bros wire, because it is hydrophilic and you can try to open it. Another option is just to be sure about this renal artery. They have, as far as I heard, they have IVUS on the table. So that you can use IVUS just to check this renal artery, because the wires and the stent are they stay quite bizarre. And maybe you should escape the wedging of the catheter into the ostium, just not if there is a dissection, not to prolong the dissection inside the artery just behind the stent, because the powerful injection could actually
yes.
the dissection hastily.
Just in fact, the right jugular now is kept within the sheath.
Yeah.
So it's quite far away.
Yes.
Нико, моля те, не диши за малко.
Oh, great.
Диши. Not bad.
Not bad, yes.
Yes. Okay. We are going to proceed with stenting. It's very well seen that the stent is pinched, let's say, in the
yes.
In the beginning.
Maybe you should implant two stents, one distal and one proximal. Because there is the dissection on the edge, and just to be sure that everything is covered.
Yeah, absolutely right. Okay, let's start.
So, maybe Ivo, we will leave you just to work quietly, just not to bother you, because it is quite a complicated situation, and the case will be available later on the site, so everybody, you can make a summary finally and to show the result. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Ivo.
Dear colleagues, we finished the case. As I promised you, after the conference, I'm updating you regarding the result and the situation with the patient. So you probably remember that we have shown that the recanalization of Leriche syndrome is absolutely successful, with excellent flow into the femoral both iliac arteries. Unfortunately, the left renal artery was not very well visible. And the advice of Professor Matthias was to recanalize, and also Professor Dobri Vasilev to recanalize. What we have succeeded to cross the mesh of the wall stent, and as you see, we put two wires within the stent into the renal artery, and after making the predilation of the crushed zone of the stent. You see, this is the wire crossing. It's in fact, it's very well seen that the proximal part of the stent is a little constrained. There was a crushing of the stent, and as we have discussed, after very stepwise and good predilation, we started with 2 millimeter coronary balloon, after that with 4 millimeter coronary balloon, and finishing with 5 millimeter non-compliant coronary balloon. This is in fact the balloon dilation. And finally, we decided to implant, this is the 5 millimeter non-compliant balloon, in order to open not only the struts, but also to achieve good crushing of the proximal zone of the first stent. And finally, we decided to implant a longer stent that will cover not only the ostial part of the stenosis, but also the distal part. And as you can see, this is after the predilation. The flow is restored, more than obvious. You see, restored flow, some spasm on the tip of the stent. And finally, this is the stent coming. This is the long stent that we have implanted, and two final projections in order to see how is the situation with the the flow itself. This is, you see, quite far away injection from the renal artery, but the flow is restored within the kidney. And the good news that the patient, after some vasodilators and heparinization, he restored the flow in the kidney, and he's in a good condition with normal flow, normal indexes of the both legs, and a slight elevation of the creatinine, but optimal condition, and he's already in rehabilitation. So this is the final case. Thank you once again for your participation, active participation, and your very active interest toward our Balkan endovascular course. Hopefully we can see you next year for the next edition of the BEC. Thank you once again. Stay safe. Thank you.